الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله ما بعد. For the hadith or for مصطلح حديث, I keep repeating some points because if you remember, like, this is maybe like the inheritance rules. Okay, we need to repeat. And I'm not going in details about the مصطلح حديث, just to know the basics. So we are talking about مصطلح حديث. What is the meaning of مصطلح حديث? This kind of science talks about the chain, to study the chain of the narrators of the hadith, and also the context. The chain, is it authentic or not? And also the context, this is authentic or not. This is the field of مصطلح حديث. Okay? And classification of the hadith, there are different types of classifications. One of them to say متواتر أحد. Okay? And we mentioned, we explained, I think, before maybe 3 weeks. What is the meaning of hadith mutawatir? If you have a hadith which was narrated by plenty of companions, more than 10, and the 10 companions also narrated the same hadith to 10 or more of tabi'in, then this is called mutawatir. But if the number of those who narrated the hadith less than 10, then this is ahad. Ahad. And I mentioned that ahad doesn't mean one. Ahad, less than 10. Less than 10. Okay? Another classification of the hadith by the types of hadith. There is something called hadith Qudsi. And we have the marfu', the mawquf, the maqtu'. Okay, what is the meaning of the Qudsi? It was said by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you'll find that the hadith, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, then قال الله تعالى. So this is called hadith Qudsi. Why? Because it is said by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there is hadith marfu'. Hadith marfu' like all the sayings of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, marfu'. Marfu'. قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم صلوا كما رأيتموني أصلي إنما الأعمال بالنيات خيركم أن تعلم القرآن وعلمه. This is مرفوع. طيب, if the sentence said by a صحابي, a companion, then this is called موقوف. موقوف. And we gave examples in the غسل chapter. One, علي بن أبي طالب, about what? غسل في عيد. And one about ابن عمر. And one about Abu Ayyub Ansari, صح? If it is said by a tabi'i, then it is called maqtu'. Yeah, for example, if there is a saying by al-Hasan al-Basri, one of the famous tabi'i. So this is maqtu'. Hadith al-ahad, if you remember, there are different types of ahad. If it is narrated by between 3 to 9 people, then it is called mashhur, famous. If it is narrated by 2, aziz. 1, gharib. How can we know that the hadith, this is maybe new, this is new and it is important to know. How can we know this hadith is authentic or not? Alhamdulillah. How can we know this hadith is authentic or not? طيب. Number one, if the author of the book mentioned that, I will mention only the authentic ahadith. And this scholar considered as an authentic scholar, like Bukhari and Muslim. So number one, how can we decide that this hadith is authentic? If the author of the book said, I will mention only the authentic ahadith, like Bukhari. And Bukhari, considered among the scholars, as a very strong scholar of hadith. He's not, some scholars mentioned that my book is sahih, but the scholars did not consider his hadith in his book, all of them authentic. Why? Because he's a mutasahil. What does it mean, mutasahil? He takes the issues easy, not strict. Bukhari is strict. If he says this, if he mentioned the hadith in his book, khalas. we don't need to study. يعني now if you read the hadith, then you mention after the hadith, رواه البخاري. This hadith narrated by البخاري. خلاص. No need to say this is صحيح. No need. This hadith narrated by Imam Muslim. No need to write this is صحيح. But if we say this hadith narrated by النسائي. Okay, then is it authentic or not? People ask. صح؟ Now if you read a book, or if someone is giving a lecture, or you are talking with your friend, and he said the hadith in Bukhari, you not ask him this is authentic or not. خلاص, he said in Bukhari, that's it. But he said the hadith in Ibn Hibban, the hadith in Tirmidhi, hadith in Musnad Ahmad. Then I need to ask, okay, this is authentic or not? Okay. So number one, I know by the author of the book. If he said my condition, I mention only the authentic hadith. The second way to know this is authentic or not, if you have a statement from one of the scholars of hadith. And for example, there is hadith. Okay, how can I know this is authentic or not? If there is a statement from, for example, Ibn Hajar. Ibn Hajar, one of the famous scholars of hadith, very strong in hadith. So khalas, this is enough. This is enough. That Ibn Hajar said this is authentic. Or Ibn Taymiyyah said this is authentic. Or for example, Nawawi, Imam Ahmed, Al-Albani. Okay? The third way, if you are a scholar of hadith and you study the chain, then you can decide this is authentic or not. So this is for the scholars of hadith. So for us, we can use the first two to decide this is authentic or not. Okay, but if I'm not a scholar of hadith, okay, يعني it is not allowed for me to decide this is authentic or not. You should mention a scholar. You should mention a scholar. Okay. And when we say you should mention a scholar, the scholars of hadith who are authentic scholars. And also, not only Albani. Yeah, some people, when you ask them, يعني, what is the definition of hadith, or what do you think that the hadith is, the meaning of the authentic hadith? If Al-Albani said this is authentic, then it is authentic. Al-Albani, rahimahullah, is one of the scholars of hadith. He's not the only scholar of hadith. So if someone say, for example, you bought a book, and in this book, all the ahadith, he mentioned Ibn Hajar, for example. Or Ibn Taymiyyah, Yahya ibn Ma'in. Is it okay? Yes, they are scholars of hadith. But now, yeah, subhanAllah, because we trust Sheikh Al-Albani, rahimahullah, we know him, we know his books, okay? So we feel comfortable if we see his name. This hadith is authentic by Al-Albani. But we should not ignore the other scholars. We should not ignore the other scholars. Yeah, and for example, if someone used a scholar other than Albani, this is not haram. We think this is haram. Some people think, no, this hadith is not authentic. Why? Albani said not authentic. Okay, but the other scholar said authentic. Ibn Hajar said it is authentic. I should not follow Albani, rahimahullah. And also, I should not oblige people to follow Albani. Or to follow Ibn Baz, or to follow Ibn Uthaymeen, rahimahullah. If they are following trusted scholars, this is very, very important. I remember when Sheikh said, I was giving halqa. So during the halqa, يعني fiqh halqa. So he mentioned hadith. Then he said, Imam Ahmed said, this is authentic hadith. But the stronger opinion that it is not authentic hadith. Imam Ahmad said it is authentic hadith, but the stronger opinion that it is not authentic hadith. The sheikh who was giving the halqa said, no, no, this is not authentic. And for the students, okay. Next time, okay, he was talking about the hadith, and the sheikh said, Al-Albani said, this is authentic hadith. But the stronger opinion that it is not authentic hadith. Then the students became angry. How come you oppose the sheikh Al-Albani? Al-Albani said the authentic, and how come you are saying it? He said, last time I said something different than Imam Ahmed, and you were silent. And now when I said something not the same like Sheikh Albani, everyone is angry. This is wrong. You are not respecting Imam Ahmed, rahimahullah ta'ala. And Imam Ahmed, no doubt, is stronger than Albani. Also Ibn Hajar. So this is one kind of taqlid. So nowadays we have taqlid also. Many people think that we are not muqallid. Habibi, you are muqallid. Those you are accusing, they are making taqlid of Imam Abu Hanifa, for example. But you are doing taqlid of Ibn Uthaymeen. You are making taqlid of Al-Albani. So why their kind of taqlid is haram and your kind of taqlid is wajib? So we should be careful, please, brothers, sisters. We should be careful that you are accusing people who are doing taqlid of Imam Abu Hanifa, one of the great Imam. If you compare Abu Hanifa and Ibn Uthaymeen, no doubt Abu Hanifa more famous than Ibn Uthaymeen. How many Muslims know Imam Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen? 1 million? 2? 10 million? 100? 1 billion? Okay, how many people know Imam Abu Hanifa?
Millions.
Billions. Okay, more than 1,200 years. So you accept to make taqlid of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen and not to make taqlid of Sheikh Imam Abu Hanifa? Okay. So many times we are doing taqlid and accusing and attacking people who are doing taqlid. Why? Okay, this is unfair. Listen, we should be careful. We should not be back to the issue of hadith. Okay, do taqlid. Why? Because I am not experienced in hadith. I am not experienced in deciding this hadith is authentic or not authentic. So in this case, what should I do? I do taqlid. I take from the Albani his opinion, then I put in my book or I narrate. Albani said sahih, Albani said da'if. Is it okay or haram? This is okay. Okay, maybe someone else wants to take from Ibn Hajar. I should not say, no, you have to take from Al-Albani. Al-Albani is a scholar of hadith, and Ibn Hajar also a scholar of hadith. Imam Ahmed is a scholar of hadith. Ibn Taymiyyah is a scholar of hadith. Khalas. If you are taking from a scholar, trusted scholar of hadith, khalas, this is okay. The same thing, fiqh. Should I take from Ibn Baz, rahimahullah? Should everyone take from Ibn Baz and Ibn Uthaymeen? No, it's not wajib. They like to take from Imam Malik. Also Imam Malik is a scholar. One of the great scholars, greater than Ibn Baz and Ibn Uthaymeen. They were taken from I'm talking about the person who doesn't know how to study. He is not experienced to study the issue. So he will make taqlid. Okay? جزاكم الله خيرا.